Hi, everybody. Mike Gleason here, and welcome as ESPN Classic presents Fighting the Mob, the story of Carmen Basilio. There was definitely no love loss when Carmen Basilio and Sugar Ray Robinson fought each other in the ring. The pugilists had two brutal fights, each winning once. Basilio respected Robinson's in-the-ring ability, but could care less for his antics outside the squared circle.
He was in love with himself. He was arrogant, a real egotist, and thought that nobody was better than him and everybody had to get down on their hands and knees for him. I'm a stubborn SOB, too, and I'm not going to get down on my knees, hands and knees, for anybody. In 1952, I had just fought Billy Graham on television. I took my wife to New York City. We were walking down Broadway. This pink Cadillac pulls up. Sugar Ray Robinson and a group get out, and I says, I want to meet him. I went up and I introduced myself, said I just fought Billy Graham last week on television in Chicago, and he gave me a brush off. I was embarrassed. And I said, someday I'm going to fight that SOB and kick his ass. That was 1952. Well, it took 5 years. By 1957, I got my chance at him.
Both Robinson and Basilio were inducted into the International Boxing Hall of Fame in 1990. Later in the show, we'll get Al Bernstein's take on Basilio. But first, we present Fighting the Mob, the story of Carmen Basilio. Thanks for watching ESPN Classic.
The champion from Canastota, New York, Carmen Basilio.
Basilio was that good that he had problems. The fight game wasn't always honest.
You faked the knockout, isn't that correct?
Yes, sir.
Quit that dirty, rotten game, she said.
I think boxing is the swill barrel of sport.
Racketeers control the so-called sport of boxing.
Frankie Carbo was a professional hitman.
Mr. Gray, that's what they called him.
He killed many, many people.
The underworld commissioner of boxing.
I respectfully decline to answer questions on the ground that I cannot be compelled to be a witness against myself.
The mob made life difficult for Carmen because they couldn't control him. They didn't want him to win.
The winner and new middleweight champion of the world!
He was in a very, very difficult spot.
His managers were particularly close to Carbo and to Gabe Genovese.
They made me think I was the biggest criminal around. I was never a mafia man.
Johnny came to me and he says, I'm going to have to hook up with the mob in order for you to get a championship fight. And I refused to give anything up.
They started to refer to Basilio as the man of courage.
Basilio was born and grew up in Canastota, New York. And out of Canastota, New York, there's a narrow highway that runs northwest to Oneida Lake. And about 4 miles out of town, there were what used to be called the mucklands. And they used to go out and pick onions in these mucklands.
You know, it's a rich black soil, but in the summer sun, it can burn your hands and burn your feet. And the weather was very temperamental. I mean, you could lose a whole year's crop in a single July afternoon when the hail came, and you could sometimes literally see it coming down the rows in the field.
If you were old enough to walk and eat, you had to work. Everybody worked. There was a job for everybody on the farm.
And they would live right there and get up at 5 o'clock in the morning, whole families of people, kids and everybody, on their hands and knees, working in onions.
We hated it. We were kids. Who wants to work when you're a kid?
One day, he said, I finally had it. I had done a little fighting, and I stood up and I said to my pa, Pa, I'm quitting. He said, what are you gonna do? I said, I'm gonna be a fighter. And he said, you'll take many a beating. And I said, yeah, and I'll give many a beating too.
My father was a boxing nut. He followed all of the fights. I remember we were little kids, and my father was going to go with a couple of his paisans to Syracuse, New York. Primo Canero was going to box an exhibition there. You take those old Italians, and one of the paisans was champion of the world. That's one of the most thrilling things in the world for them.
I think when Primo Canero won the heavyweight championship of the world, it may have been one of the only times that heavyweight championship was fixed. The poor fight game suffered more, I think, from being manipulated by the dark forces, whatever they are, than any other sport.
Gamblers and profiteers had long had their hands in boxing, but by the mid-30s, the fight game had been wholly taken over by the underworld.
After Prohibition, the mob looked for a new source of revenue. It had controlled boxing pretty thoroughly during Prohibition, but now they needed to go big time. And boxing was a great place to start, and it controlled it absolutely thoroughly.
The really big-time racketeer to enter the boxing game was Oney Madden, who was a prime bootlegger in the 20s. Somehow or another got the contract of Jack Sharkey.
They always own a piece of the champion, and own him meant they would get a percentage of his purses, and they could decide who he would fight. And the pattern was you don't let him fight anybody who you don't already have an interest in.
If anyone could succeed at swindling prize fighters, it was Paul John Carbo, alias Frank Fortunati, alias Frank Tucker, alias Jimmy the Wop.
Frank Carbo was a guy who came up in the Bronx, whose childhood was one petty scam after another, and then he started killing people for a living, linked to Murder Incorporated and all the great mobsters of Brooklyn.
His first homicide was a case where he was shaking down cab drivers in the Bronx. One cab driver was recalcitrant, and Carbo killed him. 4 years he was in hiding. Then he came back and pleaded guilty to manslaughter. He got a 2.5 year sentence.
Frankie Carbo earned his stripes in the Vito Genovese crime family, and his status rose quickly. In 1936, Vito rewarded Carbo with a stake in his cousin Gabe's middleweight champion, Babe Risco.
And Genovese says to him, look, I like you, Frankie. You've been loyal, you've been good. Why don't you say, take 20% of his fighter? So what happened was that within 6 months, Carbo figured 100% is better than 20%, and Carbo had 100%, and that was his first fighter.
From there, he began to get more and more into boxing, and he became the underworld commissioner of boxing.
If you said Carbo to someone in boxing, they'd go like this. Mr. Gray, Mr. Gray. That's what they called him, Mr. Gray.
CARMEN BASILIO knew little of the gray-haired Frankie Carbo. Clean-cut, 21, and fresh out of the Marines, Basilio had one thing on his mind, earning a living.
Somebody said to me, you want to make 50 bucks? I said, how do you do that? He said, fight a professional fight in Binghamton, New York. I said, yeah. So I turned pro, went down and had my first pro fight in Binghamton, New York, and I won by TKO in the third round. After about my third or fourth pro fight, I come home and I had my eye was all black and blue and closed. My mother, she had a fit. You quit that dirty, rotten game, she says.
Mary Basilio was more astute than she knew. By the late 1940s, New York District Attorney Frank Hogan had waged war on racketeering. He thought he struck gold the night Jake LaMotta gave up against Billy Fox.
LaMotta was a wonderful fighter that couldn't get the title shot that he wanted. And the mob came to him and said, look, you play ball with us and you get the shot. At the time, the mob was building up a guy by the name of Billy Fox. Turned out to be not that great of a fighter.
Billy Fox had a record of 43 consecutive knockouts, all fixed, I would imagine.
So LaMotta said, okay, if I get the fight, I'll take the dive.
Madame Parker writing said that the sound of splashing water was heard in Madison Square Garden last night, you know, as LaMotta took his dive.
Here's a guy who knew the difference between right and wrong then, but it didn't influence him very much.
Besides the promise of a title shot, LaMotta allegedly received a $100,000 bribe, but District Attorney Hogan had no proof. To the dismay of big-time Broadway bookmakers, Frankie Carbo and other mobsters made a killing on the fight. The scam caused enough of a stink that the New York Boxing Commission fined LaMotta $1,000 and suspended him indefinitely.
LaMotta was a street kid. Grew up in Lower East Side, went to the Bronx, fended for himself. Basilio, you know, grew up in Kennesaw, New York. Had a family, upbringing, do the right thing, and he didn't have to look towards the mobsters.
Carmen Basilio was a man with honor, a man of integrity. I always thought of him as the honest onion farmer.
Carmen Basilio was struggling to find himself as a fighter. He had broken his hand in a bout, and his career was on hold.
And I got a job to work for the Autolite Company, assembling generators. And one day I'm working, and I look back there, and there's my boss staring at me, and I said to myself, am I going to spend the rest of my life having that boss looking at me? No way, I said, I'm making a comeback.
Basilio hooked up with a couple of Syracuse area managers, John DeJohn and Joe Nitro. Nitro was well connected, and DeJohn was shrewd enough to turn Carmen into a fighter.
Well, I was a rough, tough walking sort of a guy, slugger, winding up my punches, telegraphing them and everything, and he made me put all that away and start all over again from scratch.
Basilio learned fast and soon became the terror of the welterweight division. He didn't know it yet, but he was about to clash with boxing's biggest force, the International Boxing Club, the brainchild of Chicago lawyer Truman Gibson, Gibson's friend and client Joe Louis, and New Jersey press agent Harry Mendel.
After the war, when Louis was going to retire from the title, Gibson came up with the idea that they could turn Louis's heavyweight title into an ongoing money machine in professional boxing.
The plan was that once Louis retired, an organization to promote fighters would be set up in his name.
We'd produce for Joe's corporation four fights. We would assign the fighters to Joe Louis Enterprises, and we would sell the contracts to a new corporation. Harry Mendel said, I know a crazy young Irish guy, Coral Gables, who would be interested in getting in the fight business. So he called Jim Norris at 4 o'clock in the morning. Jim said, well, I'm, you know, a little drunk now, but come out tomorrow morning and we'll talk about it.
Jim Norris was a blue blood who owned companies and businesses in many different fields, an accomplished sportsman, and a big-time gambler.
He had a big racing stable, Spring Hill Farms, had a couple of horses in the Derby. He would call to see how his horses were doing, and I'd have to read the sports page to him every morning at 7 o'clock. The New York tracks, that's where Norris got his relationship and kinship with guys in the mob.
Acting on the advice of his partner, Arthur Wirtz, Norris bought out Joe Louis for $150,000. In exchange, he got the contracts of the four top heavyweight contenders. Then, after arranging for Madison Square Garden to buy out its promoter, Mike Jacobs, Norris had a virtual monopoly on boxing promotion and a silent partner in Frankie Carbo.
You could not get a fight with the IBC unless Norris or Carbo sanctioned it, and they control the major arenas.
Jimmy Norris and Frankie Carbo, they were the Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers of boxing, the perfect duo.
It was Milton Berle and boxing that sold the first television sets.
In the 50s, we had the regular Wednesday night fights.
The Wednesday night fights are on the air.
There were the garden fights.
Live from Madison Square Garden.
We put on maybe 170, 175 fights a year.
1949, the mob delivered on its promise to Jake LaMotta, and that night, LaMotta beat Marcel Cerdan for the middleweight crown. A week later, Ezard Charles outpointed Jersey Joe Walcott to win Joe Louis's vacant title. The IBC had locked up boxing's two most lucrative belts, with Frankie Carbo controlling the other weight divisions.
The mob made life difficult for Carmen because they couldn't control him. They didn't want him to win.
But Basilio was winning, so much so that he became a star attraction on Ray Arcel's Saturday night fight card.
Ray Arcel gave a lot of fighters an opportunity. Ray was never an enemy in the sense that we worked together. He had some opponents among some of the other elements, but not ever with us.
Arcel had hoped to televise a non-title bout between Basilio and reigning welterweight champion Kid Gavilan. But John DeJohn wanted a title fight for Basilio and dove into the belly of the beast to get one.
I went to New York, I know where Carbo hung around. If you went to Carbo and you told him a story, he didn't promise you nothing. But a week or two later, you got what you asked for. Got a call to meet Jim Norris down in New York. So I went down and I saw Jim Norris. So Jim Norris says, what's this? You want to make a fight up in Syracuse with Gavilan and Basilio? What kind of money can you draw up there with? I said, that fight there, being conservative, I think we'll do 75,000.
Norris liked what he heard and outbid Ray Arcel for the fight. Basilio now had his first big break, a shot at Gavilan's welterweight title.
And I thought I won the fight, but they gave him the decision. At least I won the respect of the people that didn't give me a chance before. It kind of really surprised everybody when he put him down.
That same month, boxing was in for an even bigger surprise, only this one occurred outside the ring. The victim was Ray Arcel.
He was standing in front of a hotel in Boston, and all of a sudden he was hit from behind by apparently by a lead pipe.
They wanted to send a message to people that wanted to buck the IBC and the underworld that if you got in our way, you were going to get hurt.
He just thought it wasn't worth it after that to stay in boxing, that he would be a target again.
The Saturday night fights went off the air, and Ray Arcel disappeared from boxing for 18 years. Carbo's stranglehold on the sport was as solid as a ring post, and Carmen Basilio was headed straight for it.
Fan of Carmen Basilio's career, there were probably more great boxers active than before or since. That he is included in those ranks speaks volumes. He was called the Onion Farmer because he grew up on one in upstate New York. And he would give that nickname worldwide recognition, standing for toughness, courage, and excellence. What kind of fighter was he? Well, if you look in the dictionary next to the word aggressive, you'll see Basilio's picture. Backwards was not in his vocabulary. In his great career, he won the welterweight and middleweight crowns, fought five future Boxing Hall of Famers, and had two exciting wins over the excellent welterweight champ Tony DeMarco that are two of the best fights of that era. But the signature night of Basilio's career came on September 23rd, 1957, when he stepped up in weight to challenge middleweight champ Sugar Ray Robinson. It produced 15 rounds of total fury and a fight that is on every single top 10 greatest fights list. Basilio won the fight and the title. The sports raconteur Ben Bentley, who saw everything that mattered in sports for five decades, was the ring announcer that night. In the twilight of his years, he told me it was the absolute greatest sporting event he ever attended. I'm not a sports collector, but years ago I was given an original press packet from this Basilio Robinson fight. It's the only thing like it I've ever kept. And the only person who will ever get it from me is my young son, Wes. When he grows up, and I can tell him all about the great Sugar Ray and the man they called the Onion Farmer. For ESPN Classic, I'm Al Bernstein.
After Basilio retired from the ring, he worked as a physical education teacher at Lemoyne College in Syracuse, New York. Now let's return to Fighting the Mob, the story of Carmen Basilio, here on ESPN Classic.
I think boxing is the swill barrel of sports. It's a dirty racket in many instances, and that's the way it's going to be, as long as a hoodlum figures he can make a buck by muscling into it.
I had to hang around till June of 1955 before I got another shot at the welterweight championship.
First of all, if you're a real good fighter, word gets around pretty quickly, and most people don't want to fight you. And some of the real good fighters who might have had connections or controls, their managers or the people in control didn't want them to fight Basilio.
Basilio had no connections. He didn't want to be one of Frankie Carbo's fighters. He knew how things worked, how Carbo was pulling strings on his puppet managers, guys like Blinky Palermo, Rip Valenti, Jaime Wallman, and Bernie Glickman.
You can go on and on and on. People just fronting for Carbo.
Because he had the one conviction for homicide. He couldn't get a license in his own name to manage fighters anymore.
What Carpo was interested in was controlling you as a fighter. The only way you can get a championship fight is to sign a personal service contract with Carpo, which means if you win, then Carpo will receive percentages of all of your championship fights. If you lose, it doesn't matter because he already receives percentages from the person who defeated you.
Under Carbo's control, Kid Gavilan held the welterweight title for almost 5 years. But by 1954, he was showing signs of wear and tear, and the mob found new blood in Johnny Saxton.
Carbo had, in essence, both fighters, Saxton and Gavilan. It was a god-awful fight. The decision was given to Saxton.
With the advent of Sports Illustrated in the mid-50s, boxing became a weekly target of crusading journalists. The daily press, on the other hand, seemed to fall into two camps.
You wouldn't believe how many sports writers would be besieged with gifts, quote unquote, at Christmas time, or some would get a handout every week.
These regular beat writers would line up at the Garden after every Friday night fight and then would receive handouts and cash.
One day, LaMotta went down to the boxing commission to try to get his license back. So as we came out, LaMotta was with Al Sulbani, who was then representing him. And Al Sulbani said, no, just a minute, Bill. I said, what? And he stuck out this $20 bill. He said, Jake wants you to have it. I said, you tell Jake. And I said, no, I'll tell Jake. I said, let me tell you something, Jake. I'm insulted. I'm insulted for two reasons. Number one, you try to buy me. And number two, you try to buy me for $20.
Of the writers who could not be bought, none put up a more vigorous or more eloquent attack on the mob in boxing than Dan Parker.
For the whole decade of the 1950s, Dan Parker crusaded week after week against these gangsters.
Dan Parker was the person directly responsible for the Gabe Genovese case, the first case of a manager being convicted of undercover managing.
Carmen Basilio's managers knew what Genovese could do for their fighter. What they didn't know was how Carmen would respond.
Johnny came to me when I was the number one welterweight, and he says, I'm going to have to hook up with the mob in order for you to get a championship fight.
I had to satisfy people, otherwise I wouldn't have got nothing.
He said, you're going to have to give up some of your percentage of your pay. I said, no way. I'll get my shot, whether I give it to them or not, and I'm not giving it to them. He said, well, you're never going to get a shot. I said, well, time will tell. And I refused to give anything up. Now, whether they did or not, that's their business. I don't know.
Genovese done a service for me, and I paid him.
Now that his managers had taken in Genovese, Basilio was in the mix. He was part of a round robin with Johnny Saxton and Tony DeMarco, who were set to meet for the welterweight crown.
A jolting left hook spins Saxton sideways. DeMarco then pours 17 straight punches to the champion's head.
He hit that poor Saxton, and he got caught in the ropes in the corner. He couldn't go down. And DeMarco hit him, I don't know how many shots, like he was hitting the speed bag. Bang, bang, bang.
My fighting since I was like 11 years old, boys clubs, and always dreaming to be a champion, always dreaming to be a professional fighter, and now I'm a champion.
A couple days after this tremendous upset victory, DeMarco says, my left hand is still sore, I can't fight.
But DeMarco had signed a contract. His manager, Rip Valenti, made sure he kept up his end of the bargain. And in 70 days, he was to meet Basilio for the title.
They couldn't deny me. They had to give me a title fight eventually. I was confident that I would win the title, but it wasn't easy.
June 10, 1955, Carmen Basilio challenges Tony DeMarco for the welterweight championship of the world.
It was a savage fight, absolutely savage. It was just a pier six brawl.
It was a tough fight, hard. He had knocked me down once.
Champion goes down.
I just couldn't lay back and let him set the pace. I had to keep forcing him, make him move, make him work. Eventually, it caught up with him. I ran him out of gas, and I started nailing him.
The challenger, Basilio, is ripping into him with all he's got. That's all. The referee stops the fight at 1 minute and 52 seconds of the 12th round. CARMEN BASILIO wins the welterweight championship of the world.
He said, I'll never forget it. I just cried in the corner. I did it, I did it, I did it, he said. And his mother climbed into the ring and she kissed her son.
I was afraid she'd get hurt, trip coming through the ropes or something, because she's such a short little thing. She's only 4'10".
She explained to me, she said, you know, we worked so hard. I said, what dreams did you have? She said, we had no dreams. What could we dream about the way we lived? And that was behind that embracing scene when he won the title.
After the DeMarco fight, they started to refer to Basilio as the man of courage.
Oh, he's a champion of all time, right? So Blinky's after me. He wants a Saxton fight now, see? Got a round robin, see? So I'm down in New York with Gabe Genovese, and we're at a Gallagher Steakhouse. We're having dinner. Blinky's there. So Blinky's going, well, come on, Pally, what are you going to do here? What are we going to do? Well, he goes, I'll tell you what. We'll take $10,000 off the gate. See, I'm learning now, understand? We'll give it to you, and we'll go in Boston and fight Tony DeMarco. We'll have a sellout over there. We'll all make money. Yeah, it's a good idea, he said. All right, so that's how we got the second fight in Boston.
A 15-round World's Welterweight Championship bout, matched by the International Boxing Club, James D. Norris, president. Between the champion, CARMEN BASILIO of Canastota, New York, and the challenger, Tony DeMarco of Boston, Massachusetts. 30 seconds to go in the seventh round. And a smacking left hook, and CARMEN BASILIO's knees are of rubber. DeMarco trying to put across the big one.
He staggered me in the seventh round with a good left hook. I saw that punch coming from a mile away. Never made an attempt to block it or get out of the way.
I hit him flush. His eyes rolled over his head and his knees crossed. And I waited for him to go down. He didn't go down.
I just said, don't go down, don't go down. You're in Boston. If you go down, they'll stop the fight without even counting. And I just fought it and moved and moved and moved. And then I just worked my way around. So the bell rang, I just turned around and sat down. I was in my own corner.
Basilio regained his senses and took control, flooring DeMarco twice and finally draining the life out of him.
This fight, a duplicate of the one last June the 10th, as CARMEN BASILIO smashes Tony DeMarco into a helpless condition to have the fight called to a halt in the 12th round on a TKO.
The winner and still welterweight champion of the world, CARMEN BASILIO.
Now that DeMarco had lost twice to Basilio, it was Johnny Saxton's turn to take his shot.
CARMEN was offered the chance to fight Saxton in Chicago. There was no clause in it for a rematch. So I think really reluctantly, he went to Chicago to fight Saxton.
I was never comfortable in Chicago.
On fight night, Basilio was a 2-1 favorite. But referee Frank Gilmer reminded him of why Chicago wasn't his kind of town.
He wouldn't let me fight inside where I was strongest, and he let Saxton do the running to keep us apart. And then in the fourth round, he come out, and the stuffing was coming out of his glove.
Saxton's glove got ripped after CARMEN really hurt him, and for some reason, they couldn't find another glove for 15 or 20 minutes.
When he recovered, it rained like a deer for the rest of the fight. There was a little hanky-pank going on in that deal.
The judge's decision goes to Johnny Saxton.
I remember him telling me that he left Chicago with a broken heart.
Back in New York, Basilio secured a rematch. Behind the scenes, the usual greasing of the palms took place when Gabe Genovese collected from Basilio's managers and from the fight's promoter, Norm Rothschild.
Most boxing experts agree that Basilio's biggest asset is his excellent physical condition.
Still bitter from his defeat, Basilio trained harder than ever. This time out against Saxton, he would leave no doubt about the winner.
Mm-hmm.
Basilio had mended his broken heart, taking back the title from Saxton and the mob. Jim Norris made a mint on the fight, but his control over boxing was about to crack. Norris ran into a roadblock when a New York federal court found the IBC in violation of the Sherman Antitrust Act and ordered it to dissolve.
Bob, all I can say is we're naturally disappointed with the decision. Do you plan to make any appeal? That will be in the hands of our counsel. When we have the type reports of the Judge Ryan's decree, we'll go over them point by point and then be advised by counsel.
With an appeal in the works, Norris went ahead with his next big fight. Carmen Basilio versus a man who was bigger, badder, and bolder than the mob, Sugar Ray Robinson.
Well, Sugar Ray was training to fight Jake LaMotta for LaMotta's middleweight, world middleweight title in 1951. He was training up in Pompton Lakes, New Jersey. And the phone rang one day, and he answered it, and the voice said, Ray? He said, yes. He said, this is Mr. Gray. I want to talk to you. I'll be down outside the gate in about half an hour. Ray said, okay. So he went down, and there was a big black sedan. The window came down, and Frankie Carbo's face was in the window, and he said, Ray, I got a deal for you. You win the first fight, Jake wins the second, and the third will be on the level. And Ray said, I'm sorry, I just don't do business that way.
Robinson and Basilio shared a loathing for the mob, but oddly enough, had little respect for one another.
He had an arrogance about him that I couldn't stand. So there was never any love between he and I. It was Labor Day weekend, 1952, and my wife had never been to New York City. We're walking down Broadway. This pink Cadillac pulls up. It was Ray Robinson and his entourage. I walked over and I introduced myself, and they gave me the biggest brush off. And I felt so embarrassed, and I said, I'm going to fight that son of a bitch and kick his ass someday. 5 years later, I finally got a crack at him.
Early in the afternoon, the welterweight champion heads into Alexandria Bay, a vacation village in the Thousand Islands region. He is a real local hero, and the people of this small town will all be at the fight en masse. Robinson won't win any popularity contests around Carmen's camp since Basilio's end of the purse was cut 5% in order to meet Robinson's demand for a bigger guarantee.
Well, he's been a little bit greedy on his part, wanting all the money, and if I didn't come down 5%, the public that are entitled to a fight like this would have been deprived of it, so I came down 5% so that the people could see the fight.
Carmen was 5'6", and Robinson was 6 foot, which meant that Carmen had to punch up. And as you punch up, you lose power. So he had some real physical disadvantages going into that fight.
I had to put the pressure on him to keep him moving backwards, to keep him away from his punching power. So I had to move in all the time, punch to the body and come up to the head. I walked back to my corner at the end of the 15th round, and I says, I won this fight.
The winner and new middleweight champion of the world, Carmen Basilio.
I got goose pimples all over me, and I got called. I almost started to cry because I remember when I was in fourth grade, the teacher asked all of us children what they wanted to be when they grew up. And when they got to me, I said, I'm going to be a professional fighter, and I'm going to be champion of the world. And she said, that's the most disgusting thing I ever heard. And I was embarrassed to no end about it, but I never forgot it.
Basilio's victory against Sugar Ray Robinson lifted him into greatness. His title-winning fight at Yankee Stadium had brought in close to $1 million, and the rematch in Chicago promised even more thrills.
Carmen, and all the excitement after the weigh-in, just one question. I've polled 10 sports writers from around the nation here. 9 of them picked Sugar Ray to win by a knockout tonight. What's your answer to that?
9 of them are wrong.
Thank you, Carmen.
Thank you.
I was teaching him how to block a right uppercut and counter with a left hook. He slipped. He made a mistake.
He hit me with a right uppercut right here in the eyebrow. It broke the blood vessels open, and my eye blew up instantly.
I said, he's got a bump like the size of an egg. And I could see Carmen's eye closing.
I couldn't see to my left. I had to work hard and change my stance a little bit.
Carmen kept going, don't stop this fight, don't stop the fight.
By now, 12 rounds have rolled past in this tremendous title match. Basilio hasn't been able to see out of that left eye of his since the sixth round. Sugar Ray is really looking for a chance to finish him off.
Sports Illustrated said that not one in 100 million men could have done what Basilio did that night.
The winner and the new world's middleweight champion, Sugar Ray Robinson.
But Carbo had gone into hiding in Miami after being indicted for illegal matchmaking. Even so, he sent for Basilio to talk about making Robinson 3.
He never told me what to do. Never gave me any orders. I wouldn't take them anyway, because I didn't believe in that stuff.
Basilio set the terms, and by God, he didn't fight Robinson unless those terms were met.
He wasn't satisfied with $350,000. He said because the other guy was getting $700, which in a way he was right.
The fight never come off, and it was at the time the hottest fight in boxing.
His boxing empire lost its final appeal to stay in business. That year, the United States Supreme Court upheld a lower court's decision and ordered the dissolution of all IBC companies.
Morris and Norris' control over the Garden had to be broken up. They had to sell their shares in the Garden. Morris and Norris cried all the way to the bank because they got a tremendous return on their Garden shares.
3 months after the Supreme Court's ruling, the hunt for Frankie Carbo ended dramatically when police captured him in New Jersey.
They surrounded the place with guns drawn. Well, it turned out that Carbo had jumped out the back window, and he was immediately nailed there by the detectives from the DA's office.
Frank, the night you were arrested, you were going out the back door. You said you thought the mafia was trying to rub you out. Why would they want to do that?
It turned out that Carbo thought it was a rub out rather than a police action. So he was one frightened person.
He pled guilty. The most he could have gotten was, I think, 3 to 5 years, and he wound up getting 2 years.
Frankie Carbo was sent to Rikers Island Prison, where Gabe Genovese was also doing time for unlicensed managing. The mob's grip on boxing was coming loose. John DeJohn and Joe Nitro admitted to boxing officials they had made secret payments to Genovese and lost their licenses to manage in New York State. It would take almost 4 years before DeJohn was reinstated.
I got a bad break because that boxing commission ruined me, the New York Boxing Commission, when they banned me like that. They made me think I was the biggest criminal around. People, him, that's why I said I was a mafia man. I was never a mafia man. The evil was already there. I didn't create that evil. They had to have a scapegoat, so they grabbed me. Oh, why? Because Basilio was the hottest thing at that time. It made news.
I think probably Nitro and DeJohn tried to do their best by Basilio. They did what they had to do to get him in the ring for a championship fight.
Basilio testified before the commission and told of his meeting with Carbo in Miami. Cleared of any wrongdoing, Basilio stood by his managers. We were together, Joe, John, and myself, for 8 years, and I can only say that I would never want anyone else to handle my affairs.
The thousands and thousands of pages of testimony and evidence on this table all point towards one inescapable conclusion, and that is that during the period from 1947 through 1960, racketeers and underworld figures dominated and controlled the so-called sport of professional boxing.
In the summer of 1960, Congress held hearings on criminal activity in the fight game. Tennessee Senator Estes Kefauver, who chaired the hearings, relied on John Bonamy to lay out the case for boxing reform.
LaMotta was the leadoff witness before the Kefauver committee. I asked him whether he had taken a dive in his fight with Billy Fox in 1947.
But you don't forget whether or not you faked the knockout, do you?
No, sir.
And that's the truth. You faked the knockout. Isn't that correct?
Yes, sir.
I received an offer of $100,000 to lose to Billy Fox, which I refused. I said I was only interested in a championship fight.
Did your brother, Joseph LaMotta, state to you
the persons who were offering the $100,000 bribe?
He did not.
He had said in preliminary testimony that the bribe offer came from Blinky Palermo, who was a leading manager at the time.
Several former boxers told of the need to clean up the very sport Mary Basilio had called the dirty, rotten game. Her son Carmen was among them.
They don't have any respect for those fellas, and they don't belong in boxing, and the quicker we get those fellas out, the better it's going to be for the sport.
Here he was, from a small town, a rural guy, and to speak up and to speak out, I think, took a lot of courage.
Well, they told me, my manager, he says, tell the truth. And I said, I intend to. If you don't, it'll come back to you.
Have you ever threatened any manager or boxer or promoter at any time within the last 10 years for not carrying out any wishes? Your wishes?
I respectfully decline to answer a question on the ground that I cannot be compelled to be a witness against myself.
Carbo refused to tell the committee about his role as the underworld boss of boxing. Instead, he took the fifth 30 times.
There's only one thing I want to say, Mr. Senator. Okay. Congratulate you on your re-election.
The Kefauver hearings spawned a bill calling for federal control over boxing. The measure died in Congress when it received little support from Attorney General Robert Kennedy. Resisting the need for a national crime commission, Kennedy was less interested in policing the fight game than he was in convicting the racketeers associated with it.
Couple of fights that I had, I would take my shower, get dressed, walk out of the gym, not talk to anybody. I was 34 years old, and I'm driving in my car, and I'm all by myself, and I'm thinking about this. And I said, Carmen, it's time to retire.
In 1961, Carmen Basilio fought his last fight, a valiant but losing bid for Paul Pender's middleweight title. By this time, the legal troubles of Frankie Carbo had escalated when he and four other defendants, Blinky Palermo, Truman Gibson, Louis Dragna, and Joseph Seeker, were tried in Los Angeles on charges of extortion and conspiracy.
There was bail set for Carbo on our charge of $100,000, which in those days was a very big bail. To give you an idea how big it was, I started working as a federal prosecutor for $4,250 a year.
The government's key witness was West Coast matchmaker Jackie Leonard. Leonard had promoted the welterweight title fight between Virgil Akins and Don Jordan, and then refused to give up a piece of Jordan. When the mob came to collect, Leonard was attached to a pair of FBI wiretaps.
Carbo called Leonard cross-country and told him he was going to come out there to the West Coast and gouge out his eyes.
The mob flourished under J. Edgar Hoover until Bobby Kennedy came in as attorney general and said, let's get the mob.
Lead prosecutor Alvin Goldstein and assistant counsel Robert Heinerfeld were chosen to try the government's case against Carbo and his associates.
When Palermo was being cross-examined by Goldstein, Goldstein had got him to lay out their modus operandi of controlling fight titles. And finally, Palermo says, we've been doing this for years. This is the first time they made a case like this out of it.
By the end of the three-month-long trial, the government's case proved overwhelming, and all five defendants were found guilty.
To work for the Genesee Brewing Company out of Rochester, New York. And within a week after that, I had a telephone call from the athletic director at Le Moyne College, and they offered me a job there as a phys ed teacher.
Basilio had gone back to a simple life, far from the arenas where he had pounded out a living with his fists, farther still from the dark forces he had battled outside the ring.
Camus has a character in one of his novels say that sanctity and heroism don't matter to me. What interests me is in being a man. And I think Carmen Basilio is a man, a good man.
Carmen and I, we got close because many times we were together at different events, and we became friends. My son was 14 years old. He died from a car accident. Basilio, he heard about it, and for respect that he had for me, he came to Boston, he stayed with us, he came to the funeral with us, and that was, I never forget him.
Basilio was a great fighter, had all the bravery and grit that we all like to see in a fighter.
He was ferocious in the ring. He was humble enough to kneel in the ring. He was man enough to cry in the ring. Tony DeMarco probably said it best. At their 30th reunion of the night that Basilio won the welterweight championship of the world, over the years, I've come to understand that I couldn't have lost to a better fighter or a better human being than Carmen Basilio.